Hello learners, I am Dr. Mrs. Parveen Sharma, Associate Professor, Hindu College of Education, Sonipat. Welcome you all in NIOS studio in the course program 509 DLED Pedagogy of Social Science. Well friends, today in this session, we'll discuss about the topic National Integration and International Understanding. Well, in the beginning, we will discuss what do we mean by national integration. What is its meaning? It is said by Dr. Radhakrishnan, if India is to remain free, united and democratic, education should train people for unity and not localism, for democracy and not dictatorship. Meaning by, if we want that all of the Indian have to be remain united, we have to tell them what do we actually mean by to be democratic. What do we mean by nationalism? It is a sense of love, loyalty, respect, honor and devotion towards own country. When any individual has a feeling of love for language, history, traditions, ideals and culture of his or her nation, and these are reflected in his or her behavior, we can say this is nationalism. Let me elaborate more on this. You know, when one has a feeling for history and love for the language and culture, so that love should be reflected in his or her behavior. When this kind of behavior is reflected, we can say that particular individual is having a feeling of nationalism. It can be said that national integration is that cementing force that binds the citizens of country in unity. National integration means social, political, economic, linguistic and cultural unity. Let me tell you more clearly, what do we actually mean by it? It is a cementing force which try to bind all the citizens, all the people who are living in the country, and the dimensions are socially, politically, economically, linguistically and culturally. When we feel that we are united on these dimensions, then we can say this is national integration. National development is the development of a mental climate that would help react in terms of oneness, irrespective religion or language of the people concerned. You know, when we feel that we belong to this region particularly, we belong to this religion or we belong to this language, and we are, if quarreling on these issues, then we cannot say that we are united. So, by national development, we have to create a sort of climate that one feels that we are united in terms of region, religion and language of the people concerned. We should not quarrel on these issues. So let us see how the different educationists have defined national integration. We'll discuss the two one. As Professor Humayun Kabir has said, nationalism or national integration is that which depends on the we feeling towards nation. When we do not bother about I feeling, rather we feeling, when we are feeling for the countrymen, we are feeling for the nation. And then if I talk about educationist S.N. Panda, who has said, national integration is a psychological phenomena, a feeling of oneness that rises above all narrow and divisive tendencies and make for genuine patriotism and progress. Then we feel that no divisive tendency can divide us, because we are having a feeling of true patriotism and we are thinking for the progress of the nation, because we are not having a I feeling, rather we are centered on the we feeling, as Professor Humayun Kabir also has said. So on these two definitions, we can say, we can conclude that we can infer or we can find, we can say that national integration is a feeling of love and unity, when we have a feeling of love for each other and we feel that we all are united and we have a desire to live together. You know, it is one of the aim of education also, that we have to learn how to live together. That will be possible when we have a feeling of tolerance, sympathy and love for each other. So we should have a desire to live together, feeling of harmony and oneness. So we have a sort of feeling that each and everyone every individual in the society has to be respected, and we are showing that kind of respect. That is what we mean by feeling of harmony, so that there can be establishment of peace throughout the whole country and merger of individual interest. If we are working on the basis of our vested individual interest, in that sense, in that case, we cannot think of the progress of the nation. So we have to think that we have to merge our individual interest, and we have to think in the interest of the nation. Then feeling of nationhood, when we have sacrificed the feeling of vested interest or the feeling of I, then we can create a feeling of nationhood and sense of worthwhileness. It implies when each and every individual is having a belief in the philosophy of the the progress of the nation, and when one is having a commitment, a sense of desire, and sort of commitment and desire to work for the progress, for the strength, and for the prosperity of the nation, then feeling of oneness in India, that we all are one and we belong to human being, and unity in diversity. We will be discussing more what do we mean by unity in diversity. So on the basis of this discussion, we can say, we can infer that we have to create a feeling that we are united. Of course, we have diversity in our country, in languages, in religion, in climate, in our food, in our habits, but then even then, being that diversity, we are feeling that we are united one. Now, after knowing the meaning and the definitions of the national integration, we will see what are the various dimensions of national integration, how can we decide that these are the parameters on which we can think and we can decide that this is what we mean by national integration. First is the social integration, economic integration, linguistic integration, then cultural integration, then emotional integration. Well, friends, we will be discussing in brief one by one. So first of all, I'll discuss with you what do we mean by social integration. You know, friends, the quality like faith in democracy, tolerance, cooperation, and passion for social justice are highly required. If we want to remain socially integrated, we have to learn to accommodate others. Social sensitivity is essential. You know, you can feel that you find individuals who are preaching a different thing, but they are practicing a different policy. No, if we are to create a feeling of nationality and nationhood, then we have to develop a feeling of social integration. That is, first we should have a faith in democracy, that we have to create a feeling of oneness, and we should believe in social justice, and whatever do, our action should also depict or reflect our feeling of social justice and the feeling of tolerance. We have to learn to tolerate the feelings and the sentiments of the other person. If we are having that kind of quality, only in that case we will be able to develop an environment of harmony and peace in surrounding area. And if we want to remain socially integrated, we have to learn to accommodate others. You know, try to understand when I say we have to learn to accommodate others. My dear friends, we have to cooperate others. We have to value the opinion of the other person. If we say that, if we feel that I am only right on this issue, then it means I am not learning how to accommodate others. So we should have a feeling, rather, in the coming time I'll be discussing in the methodology and the role of the teacher, that a teacher should try to inculcate this value among his or her students, that how to learn to accommodate others. And social sensitivity is essentially, what do we mean by social sensitivity? It means we know there's a term empathy, not sympathy. We do not require sympathy of the person. Rather, empathy means try to put yourself in the position of the other person. In that case, we can develop a social sensitivity, and empathy is essential. So this is what we mean by social integration. And next dimension is the economic integration. There is a need to remove economic disparity. It means no favor on the basis of class, rather to make efforts in improving the general living standard of people. You know, if the rich are becoming more rich and the poor are becoming more poor, then the gap between the classes will be increased. And if the gap between the classes is increased, then the in the case of economic disparities, there will be differences among the people. Then the people will start quarreling on the basis of class. Rather, we have to make efforts in improving the general living standard of people. If we are able to fulfill that objective of our education, what is I mean to improve the general living standard of people, then in that case we will see that each individual on this earth in our nation will be happy. When everyone is happy, definitely his or her standard of living is improved and one remains in a state of happiness, because you know one can sprinkle the fragrance of happiness on others when one is happy internally. So we are supposed to create a sort of environment where everyone is having fulfillment of his or her basic needs. So economic integration leads us to the national integration, and the next dimension is linguistic integration. It means learning and respecting all languages. It means learning to interact with speakers of different languages for the benefit of all. You know, we have seen time and again people are quarreling on the issue of languages, when we know that there are so many languages and the speakers of those languages are available all around the country. So we are not supposed to feel or say that this language is better than the another one. We have to learn to respect all the languages so that we can interact with the speakers of different languages, and that will be in the benefit of all. So we are not supposed to quarrel or fight on the basis of the language. Then in the next dimension we will discuss cultural integration. There exist various cultures in India. Appreciation of other culture and mutual assimilation leads to enrichment of culture. Friends, we are trying to discuss the different dimension which lead to national integration. So cultural integration, we know there are various religions, so definitely there are various cultures in India, and we have to learn to appreciate the other cultures. If I am appreciating or one is appreciating his or her own culture, then one cannot learn to respect the other culture, and when one cannot learn how to assimilate. Assimilation is very important if we want that the welfare of the country is the topmost, and if we want the progress of the country, we have to learn how to assimilate mutually on the basis of culture. It means we have to respect all the festivals of all the cultures, and it will lead us to the enrichment of the culture. Then the emotional integration. Now, emotional integration is a part of national integration, meaning by for the training of mind and heart is required. We cannot perform anything nicely if our mind is thinking differently and if our heart is having a different emotion. So we have to adopt a policy when we can train the mind and heart, meaning by that the mind and heart should work in the coordination. So coordination of intellectual and emotional aspect is essential. It helps the people to stand for common cause and becoming loyal to nation. When we are standing on the common cause, then we can be loyal to nation. And when one is having emotional desire that we have to think, that I have to think for the benefit of the nation, and that should that feeling should come out from internally, when internally, not by the force. If are forced to say this, forced to feel this, that cannot last long. But when one is having this desire internally, emotionally, one is feeling that this is my nation and I have to think, I have to work for the betterment of my nation. For that feeling, for that task, we have to stand for a common cause. So our mind and heart should work in coordination. So that type of emotional integration will lead us to the national integration. So well, friends, by now We have come to know that different dimensions, social dimension, cultural dimension, linguistic dimension, economic dimension, they all are the parts of national integration, and one is supposed to take the nation towards national integration or towards unity when all these dimensions are well taken care of. So after knowing the dimension, well friends, let us discuss what is the need of this national integration. Why I am asking you that we have to learn to be united. There is a saying, united we stand and divided we fall. This is a very old proverb. Let us prove this proverb in our further discussion. So what is the need? First is that to build a mighty nation. If we want that our nation should be mighty one, not in the literal sense, rather in mighty in our action, mighty in our thoughts, and to eradicate casteism and provincialism. Most of the time, people are quarreling on the issue of casteism, that, oh, this person belong to my caste, I should make favor to this, that this person belong to my province, to my area, so I should show favor to this fellow. Then we cannot take our nation to the united one. So we have to eradicate this feeling of casteism and provincialism to promote Indian culture. Just now, a second before, I have discussed with you, I have spoken to you that we have to learn that mutual assimilation or respecting the other cultures, only in that case we can promote the Indian culture. To establish unity, if we are respecting all the cultures which are over there in our India, we can be able to establish that kind of unity. Unity in diversity, when we know that there are so many religions, so many languages, so many religions. Of course, we in our constitution talk about secularism. It means we are not professing for any particular religion or region. So we have to see that, of course, we are having diversity on these issues, on these dimensions, but even then we have to learn how to be united. Of course, there is diversity, but unity in diversity is a unique trait of our nation. And no fear of external attack. My dear friends, if we are united, then there is no fear of external attack. We are not to remain in fear that any time the external power can attack on our country. Because we are united, so we are not supposed to make fear of that. To maintain democracy, if we want to maintain our democracy, we have to be united. And for social upliftment, we have to be united. Then for economic progress, if we want that there should be no gap between the classes, and we should not quarrel on the basis of the class, and we have to make, or we have to eradicate that economic disparity, in that case we can be moving towards economic progress. And for peace and harmony, this is the inborn desire of any individual, that one wants peace, one wants happiness, one wants harmony. So as a person, as a countryman, it should be our topmost priority, topmost feeling, topmost desire that we have to create peace and harmony in our country. So keeping in mind all these factors, all these aspects, we can very well say that there is a great need of national integration in our country. So by now, it's clear to us that there is a great need of national integration, and there are various dimensions on which we have to think and we have to work. But after knowing the need of the national integration, I'm sorry to say there are so many barriers and problems in the way of national integration. There are many, and few of them I'll discuss: casteism, communalism, lingualism, provincialism, social differences, economic differences, lack of leadership, frustration among youth, character formation. So I'll be taking one by one. First, if I talk about casteism. Now, casteism is the greatest obstacle in national unity. Loyalty towards own caste becomes a reason for aggression of another caste. Suppose there is an interview, and if the authority tries to show the favor to the person of their own caste, what will be the result? Definitely the people who belong to another caste will be aggressive, and it is enough to make angry the people of the another caste. So casteism is the greatest obstacle. We should try to eradicate this problem from our nation, and we cannot expect everything from the government. Individually, everyone has to make effort for this. And the second obstacle is the communalism. When communities work on the basis of community, not on nationalism, it results into communal riots which disturb the unity. Third is the lingualism. Language controversy has always been an obstacle in unity, that this is the language which should be given priority. Then provincialism. Border dispute and considered the another one inferior is really bad, you know, meaning by if we consider that this person who is apart this border is inferior to me, then this dispute is enough to make the country disrupted. Then the social difference, to hate each other on the basis of class is another, that I am rich and another person is poor. This belong to the higher strata, this belong to the lower strata. This is enough to make people angry and quarrel with each other. And it, moreover, it hurts the sentiments of each other. Then the economic differences. There is gap in the people on the basis of rich and poor. Bad economic conditions compel the people to fight with each other. And the lack of leadership is another obstacle. For the success of democracy, we need good leaders. But what will happen if leaders are involved in their vested interests? So it is essential that leadership should be good. We require good leaders who can take the nation to the progress. Then frustration among youth, corruption, favoritism, unemployment, etc. increase the frustration among youth. Then character formation, bribery, adulteration in food and other bad tendency weakens the character of youth, which poses a great danger to national unity. If we see that our youth is frustrated, that is due to the bribery or the bad tendency or the showing the favoritism to one class or one caste or people belonging to one provinces. So in that case, what will happen? The character formation, bribery, adulteration in food and other bad tendency weakens the character of youth, which poses a great danger to national unity. Because if we see that the youth is frustrated on the basis of giving bribery or showing favoritism to the people of one class, it will pose a great obstacle, a great danger in the way of national unity. Then let us see what are the objectives of education for national integration. Education should aim at teaching students the culture and tradition of India. It should inculcate among students the understanding other cultures. Right type of attitude and values should be developed among students. The national outlook of students should be broadened so that they can rise above prejudices, parochialism and regionalism. And you know, intellectual awareness of students should be created so that they can form opinion against narrow-mindedness. A feeling of cooperation and tolerance should be developed among them. So when we know that these are the objectives of our education, so for the betterment of the country and to have national integration, we have to see that our education should fulfill these objectives, that our youth should learn how to cooperate, how to be tolerant, and how our outlook should be broadened. So we have to see how we can educate our youth, our youngsters. Let us see some educational policy. National policy of education. In our national policy of education, it has been emphasized that the right attitude and the right values should be inculcated in our youth. Then aims of education. Even our education is having the topmost aim, that is the harmonious development or the holistic development of youth. Then redesigning the curriculum. Well, friends, if we want that our children, our students should be inculcated with these values. They should be taught these values. So we have to redesign our curriculum and redesign our textbook. We have to give, or we have to quote such examples in our textbook which are teaching to the students that we belong to India and this is not my religion, this is not my province, I belong to India, I do not belong to any particular religion. So it means we have to teach our students, and for that teaching, for that education, we will have to redesign our textbooks and we have to organize co-curricular activities in our school. There can be various activities in our school, like we can celebrate national festivals. If we are living in the eastern area or the northern area, it doesn't mean that we have to celebrate Diwali only. We can celebrate Diwali, we can celebrate Christmas, we can celebrate Eid. So if we are celebrating the festivals of each religion, it will convey a feeling in our students that we have to respect all the religion and we belong to all the religion. So we have to learn to accommodate each religion, each festival. So this way, by organizing co-curricular activities in the school in the form of celebrating national festival, we can inculcate this feeling among our children, among our students. Then morning assembly, daily we can have a morning assembly, and in that assembly we can roll number wise or class wise or the row wise, we turn by turn, we can ask each and every student to present his or her own views about the nation, or we can inculcate good values through morning assembly. There they can recite some poems, they can sing some patriotic song or any speech or declamation on the history of our great persons. Then we can take educational tours to different places, so that not by the textbook, rather taking them to the excursion, we can teach them. And then cultural exchange program of the teacher. Some of the teacher from the north can be sent to the east, or some teacher from the south can be invited to the north, or the this way we can have a cultural exchange program of the teachers. In that case, students can learn to respect the language or the religion, and they can learn the culture or history of the other region or the other religion or the other province. Then the documentary, some documentary education movies can be telecasted in the schools, so that it should not become a boring phenomena for the students by learning through lectures or learning through textbooks only. So by watching documentary, good educational films, students can learn and they can enjoy also. The national and social service programs can be organized in our institutions. There, for example, these days our government has run a program of cleanliness. So such kind of cleanliness campaign we can start, and we can ask our students to participate in that cleanliness program, so they can take participation in that campaign, or they can learn how to respect these programs. So we can do this thing. Then we talk about the international understanding is world citizenship. We generally say Vasudhaiva Kutum. It means all human beings are fellows and members of world family. It means love, sympathy and cooperation among all the people of all nations. Internationalism is a feeling that the individual is not a member of his state but a citizen of the world. And we can see that what is the need of international understanding. Guru Gobind Singh has rightly said, all human beings belong to the same caste, same human being, the color of their blood is the same, they have same organs, the difference in the place of living will not make any difference, all the human beings belong to the same creed. We can promote the feeling of oneness with this feeling, because means of transport also have brought the world closer. And no nation is self-sufficient or self-reliant. One has to take help of other, and we can help the each individual, each nation, that we have to cooperate each other, each nation, because we are not self-reliant. there are many barriers, physical barriers, political barriers, economic barriers, religion barriers, or linguistic barriers, psychological barriers, educational barriers. What are the ways and means? Let me discuss briefly that we can organize co-curricular activities in the school. Then curriculum should enable our students how to promote better understanding and interdependence of the people, to make people learn, to make a adjustment, to enable people to learn how to replace conflict with cooperation, to learn skills, how to build this world a better place to live in through the subject of history, then geography, then science, civics, philosophy, and through music, we can teach them. And a teacher, what is the role of teacher? A teacher has to present a role model. Teacher has to show his positive attitude, her positive attitude through his or her behavior. His or her look should be broadened, and his or her own philosophy of life should be broadened so that teacher can inculcate the feeling of international understanding among the students. So we see that in the first phase, we discussed what do we mean by national integration? If we are to stay united on the basis of nationhood, we have to understand the importance of international understanding. So, in this way, I hope it is clear to everyone how the national integration can be established and how much important is the international understanding. So, what are the steps which take us to the establishment of national integration and international understanding? So, teacher can play a vital role in this. I hope this is clear to you. Thank you very much.